Flying No Fear by Captain Adrian Akers-Douglas and Dr. Georgiou. Introduction. The writers hope that this book will help the many people who are apprehensive about flying. Sometimes unnecessary anxiety is caused by events that airline crews may take for granted, including aspects of flights that are mystifying and even alarming to less frequent flyers. Part 1 of this book takes listeners through a typical flight, explaining in non-technical terms just what is happening at any point in the journey. This is followed by Part 2, that deals frankly with some of the aspects of flying that may be a cause of worry. Part 3 offers a professional explanation of the phenomena that cause anxiety and offers an unusual perspective on dealing with it. If this little publication helps listeners to come to terms with an extremely safe form of travel, it will have served its purpose. Part 1. The flight now departing. Center of attention. As you leave home to check in for your flight, the professionals who will be responsible for your comfort and safety will probably already be at work. You may have seen how an aircraft becomes the center of a hive of activity when it lands. Baggage and catering is unloaded and loaded. Fuel and water are pumped on. The cabin is cleaned and readied for the next flight, and a series of checks are performed. Aircraft are usually serviced on a continuing basis. Whenever they land, certain checks and examinations will be undertaken. Then, at prearranged intervals, the aircraft is taken out of service for a few hours, days, or even weeks, while even more elaborate maintenance is carried out. While the engineers, caterers, cleaners, baggage handlers and refuelers are attending to the aircraft, the flight deck and cabin crews will be reporting for their briefings. Planning. The flight deck crew is supplied with all the details concerning the flight, the weather en route and at the destination, the number of passengers and the weight of freight being carried, a computer-generated plan of the route, predicting the flight time and fuel needed, and any other details that might affect the flight. The captain then decides on the amount of fuel to be loaded, which will be enough to fly to the destination, then to another airfield should the destination, for any reason, be closed when the flight arrives, and an extra amount on top of that. Simultaneously, a flight plan, giving details of the time and height at which the aircraft will pass over various points along the route, together with its estimated time of arrival at the destination, is sent to all the aircraft control centres responsible for regulating the flow of traffic along the route which the flight will take. These centres then start to integrate our flight with all the other flights with which we shall be sharing airspace. Eventually, we will be given a time at which our flight must depart in order to fit in with the other traffic. Usually, this is very close to the scheduled departure time. While the flight deck crew completes its briefing, the cabin crew leader will be ensuring that his or her colleagues are fully aware of what they have to do in any emergency, that they know where all the related equipment is to be found on the aircraft, and how to operate it. Only then will they turn to how they intend to conduct the passenger service, the needs of any special cases, handicapped people, unaccompanied children and so on, who will be on board, and any specific details relating to the flight. At least half an hour before the flight is due to depart, the crew will go out to the aircraft. The cabin crew check the emergency equipment, such as fire extinguishers, medical kits, and the portable oxygen bottles, which are kept in the cabin for use if a passenger is taken ill, and then they ensure that all the catering and bars are in order. They will also ensure that the cabin looks neat and tidy for our guests. Checking the aircraft. Meanwhile, the pilots will be running through an exhaustive series of checks on the various aircraft systems, and loading the day's flight information into the computers. One of the pilots will also examine the outside of the aircraft, double-checking an inspection that has already been carried out by the ground engineers. When the crew is satisfied with the condition of the aircraft, the passengers will be called. By the time the customers arrive, much of the activity around the aircraft will have subsided, although there will probably still be last-minute baggage and freight to load, and you may still see the flight deck crew busy with their checks. When everyone is on board, the cabin crew count heads. It's important that exactly the number of passengers expected are on board. Too many, and someone has probably got on the wrong flight. Too few, and a baggage identification procedure has to be implemented to ensure that no one has checked in any luggage and then disappeared. In these days of random terrorism, such risks are unacceptable. Some people have cottoned on to the fact that if their bags are on board, it's unlikely that they'll be left behind, and have abused the system by keeping everyone else waiting long after the aircraft doors should have been closed. This is extremely frustrating for both the crew and all the other passengers who have managed to get themselves to the aircraft on time, especially in these days of crowded skies, when we're given a place in the queue of aircraft waiting to start, with long delays being the penalty for missing one's turn. In the past, having to do a baggage ident took a long time, and we were prepared to do almost anything to find the lost sheep before having to resort to unloading and having the passengers point out their own belongings. However, be warned. If you have been playing this game, technology is catching up with you. More and more airlines and airports now have sophisticated baggage tracking systems which will indicate almost exactly where in the aircraft's hold the miscreant bag is. It is now very much easier to trace luggage and heave it off the aeroplane if you don't show up on time. Doors closed. If the passenger count is correct, we can get going. The last of the ground personnel leave and the doors are closed. You may then hear the cabin crew leader telling his staff to arm the doors. Each of the doors and the overwing exits are equipped with slides to help people escape from the cabin in the event of an emergency landing. These slides are inflated by compressed air. Sometimes they can also be used as life rafts if the aircraft has to land on water. When the slides are armed, they will automatically inflate when the doors are opened. There is little quite so embarrassing as forgetting to disarm the slides after landing, arriving at the terminal, opening the door, and watching aghast as a writhing rubber slide unwinds in front of the bemused passengers and ground staff. Thus, it's essential that the cabin crew checks that the slides are disarmed after the aircraft has landed safely at its destination. Starting up. Clear to start. The pilots will then call the control tower for permission to start the engines. Providing all the air traffic control regions through which the aircraft will pass and the destination airport can accept the flight without delays, permission to start will be given. If, on the other hand, the airspace along the route is congested, we may suffer one of those tedious delays awaiting a place in the queue. If this happens and the delay is going to be lengthy, the captain will contact the airline's operations office to try to work out an alternative routing which may be less busy. This sometimes works, but at other times, especially at peak holiday periods, there is just such a volume of traffic that all routes are jammed. Then patience and good humour are the qualities most in demand from passengers and crew. With permission to start granted, the flight really comes to life, accompanied by what may seem to some people like rather alarming whines, clunks, whirs and various other sounds. Start engines. The first noticeable indication that the engines are being started is when the flow of conditioned air to the cabin is cut off. The engines on most aircraft are started using compressed air from the same source that supplies the air conditioning and electricity on the ground. A small jet engine, called an auxiliary power unit or APU, usually located in the tail of the airliner. The APU cannot provide enough air for both air conditioning and the engine starter system. So the cabin conditioning is shut off for the short time it takes the engines to start. The aircraft often trembles slightly as the engines gather speed and the cabin lights may flicker briefly as the engine-driven generators take over the supply of electricity from the APU. Once the engines have started, you may hear a series of strange sounds, apparently coming from underneath the floor of the cabin. These are caused by the pilots moving the slats and flaps into the position required for takeoff. High lift devices. Slats and flaps are the bits that droop down from the front and back of the wing on takeoff and landing. Flaps hang down at the back of the wing and slats at the front. They're known as high lift devices. What are they for? Aircraft wings are a compromise which have to meet two different requirements. During the cruise at high altitude, we want the aeroplane to fly quickly. This requires a certain shape of wing. But when we're taking off and landing, we want to fly slowly so that we don't use up too much runway. This requires a completely different shape of wing. Since no one has yet invented a fully flexible rubber wing, the designers arrange a compromise by fitting slats and flaps to the wing, which effectively alter its shape to fit the phase of flight. The slats and flaps are electrically or hydraulically operated, which accounts for those sounds as they move in and out. The flight deck crew complete a series of checks after the engines are started, and then get permission from the control tower to taxi out to the runway. Wheels rolling. If you're sitting near a window, you may see the ground engineer, who has supervised the startup, waving the crew off and perhaps holding up what appears to be a broad red ribbon. This is attached to a finger-sized pin, which is inserted into the nose wheel assembly while the aircraft is pushed back from its parking stand. This pin disables the nose wheel steering system, so that the tractor which pushes the aircraft back does not damage the aeroplane's steering mechanism. The crew want to know for sure that the ground engineer has pulled this pin out and thus restored their ability to steer the aircraft on the ground, which is why he waves the red ribbon at them. As the aircraft taxis out, you may see various panels rising and falling on the wing as the pilots check the controls. As they proceed towards the runway, the crew will also be receiving their instructions for the departure and the route to be followed for the flight from the control tower. While all this is going on, the cabin crew will be showing the passengers what to do if an emergency should occur during the flight, the aviation equivalent of the traditional nautical boat drill.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.